Well, hello and welcome to this very special Adam Smith Institute webinar. My name is Matthew Lash and I'm the head of research at the Adam Smith Institute. And as you can see, we're being joined by, in conversation with my colleague, Matthew Kilcoyne, who is our deputy director, as well as Tyler Goodspeed, who is our latest senior fellow. Tyler is the Kleinheinz fellow at the Hoover Institution at the Stanford University, and he's the US director at Greenmantle LLC, a macroeconomic and geopolitical advisory firm. In 2019, Tyler was appointed a member of the US President's Council of Economic Advisors, and he served as chairman from 2020 to 2021. Tyler advised on the administration's response to the coronavirus pandemic, as well as serving as chief economist for macroeconomic policy and senior economist for tax, public finance, and macroeconomics, playing an instrumental role in designing the 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. Before joining the council, Dr. Goodspeed was in the Faculty of Economics at the University of Oxford and was a lecturer at King's College London. He's published extensively on financial regulation, banking, and monetary economics, which we'll be talking about in our discussion today, as well as he is the author of Legislating Instability, Adam Smith, Free Banking, and the Financial Crisis of 1772. He received his BA, MA, and PhD from Harvard University and his MPhil from the University of Cambridge, where he was a Gates Scholar. So in our main part of the discussion today, we're going to be kind of focusing in on Tyler's time in the White House, his latest academic research, as well as where he thinks the global economy is going. But we're also going to try to save plenty of time for questions from the audience. Thank you, Tyler. Welcome.
Great to be with you. And I have to say, unfortunately, it's only 10 a.m. Pacific time, so I'll be unable to join folks in that long Adam Smith Institute tradition of enjoying a glass of wine during these things.
Well, hopefully we'll all be back having glasses of wine soon. And the real question is, who do you think is going to win the game? But I'm sure we've got you here for other reasons. I think you've now, let's say, feeling more relaxed out of the White House. You're the first millennial to make your way moving into California. How have you found the experience of getting out of the White House and returning to civilian life?
Well, it's strange not having two phones on your person at all times. It's strange not having two laptops on your person at all times. And though I'm keeping plenty busy, the intensity is certainly less than what I became used to over 3.5 years. And in moving to California, I certainly do seem to be swimming against the migratory tide with most other folks net out migrating.
Yeah,
absolutely. Why do you reckon people are moving away from California, moving towards Texas, moving towards the East Coast? Why have you decided to do the opposite?
Well, I decided to do the opposite because I had an attractive job offer and, you know, always love my colleagues here at the Hoover Institution. And so wanted to come out here and join them. I had actually been deferring for a number of years. And certainly it's a relatively good time to enter the Bay Area rental market, which has been particularly hard hit over the past year. And yes, it's been sort of a long puzzle why US states and even within states, US localities that have particularly high regulatory burdens, particularly high costs of housing, particularly high tax burdens, why nonetheless people still tend to gravitate to certain centers like the Bay Area, like New York, instead of moving to relatively low cost, relatively low regulatory burden, relatively low tax areas. And this just illustrates, I think, the power of agglomeration effects, right? That, you know, if you want to be in tech, you've got to be located where other tech people are. And I think we're sort of observing where the tipping point of the pull of those agglomeration effects is, which is actually probably a good thing because, you know, there's been some recent research just in the past couple of years that points to the magnitude of the economic losses of excessively restrictive housing policies. Shea and Moretti have a paper out recently, and Leah Hanian, Ed Prescott, and Kyle Herkenhoff that basically look at what, how much bigger would US GDP per capita be if the whole country had sort of Texas levels of zoning restrictions, or if just certain areas like the Bay Area and New York City had median levels of zoning restrictions. And I can't remember off the top of my head the numbers, but we were talking about really big, real economic gains from moving to those lower levels of zoning restrictiveness. Yeah. And intuitively, it makes sense because there's no such thing as a free lunch, but it's a pretty cheap lunch to just take people from where unemployment, or to allow people to be able to move from where unemployment is relatively high and productivity growth relatively low to places where productivity growth is relatively high and unemployment relatively low.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a big debate, of course, in the UK as well when it comes to planning reform that we're very heavily steeped in. According to some estimates, freeing up the housing market could boost GDP in the UK by 20% over a decade or so. And that would, of course, push the UK above Germany, the ultimate victory over Germany, in my opinion, not the football game this evening. And I think you're right that there's a need to, really, if nothing else from a social mobility perspective, if we want people to have the opportunity, you should let them move closer to where they're most productive. But just stepping back into the deep, dark previous life that you used to hold with your mobile phone constantly ringing and nauseating worry in the middle of the evening about what's coming next, I'm wondering if we could think about kind of what you see as some of the main economic achievements from the Trump administration, and what don't we hear about very much? With the kind of sometimes ripe for criticism in other areas about the economic record during those 4 years?
Right. So I think one of the signature achievements of the Trump administration pre-pandemic was delivering real wage, income, and wealth gains across the wage, income, and wealth distribution, but particularly among the within the lower ends of those distributions. And so, I mean, just for example, in the first 3 years of the Trump administration, real wage growth at the 10th percentile, so this is the bottom 10% of the wage distribution, real wage growth for those folks was 10% at an annual rate. That was more than double real wage growth at the 90th percentile, so for the top 10%, who also experienced big real wage gains of 5%. But then also since the 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, real wealth, real net worth for the bottom 50% of the wealth distribution rose by 28%, while that of the top 1% rose 9%. And the bottom 50% share of real net worth rose while that of the top 1% declined. Labor share of income increased. And the fascinating thing is that this was a reversal of trends that had previously been underway during the preceding expansion. So basically from July 2009 through the end of 2016, when we actually saw rising wage, income, and wealth inequality. And so what was really exciting, I think, was after 2016, but particularly after 2017, whereas before, during the expansion, we saw wage growth for managers outpacing that of workers, wage growth for the top 10% outpacing that of the bottom 10%, wage growth for males outpacing that for females, wage growth for white Americans outpacing that of African Americans. After 2017, we saw all those trends reverse. And I thought that was a signature achievement of the administration that didn't get much coverage.
And how did that achievement actually come about? So how did which policies do you think had the most impact on achieving that real wage growth for those lower deciles? And then were they free market policies or were these interventionist policies? Should we be concerned about the level of spending and debt that was accrued during that period of time? And will we see are we going to see that those policies are tied to a social conservatism and politically as well as, or are they going to be tied to a period which we can never recreate because they were tied to something which was so partisan in politics in the US?
It's a good question. And I think to answer that, it's important to reflect on the nature of the recovery from 2008, 2009 through the end of 2016. So this was the slowest labor market recovery that we've seen in the United States. So it took 77 months to regain the jobs lost during the 2008-2009 recession. 77 months compared to a historic post-war average of 24 months. And one of the remarkable things about this expansion through 2016 was that we actually saw two historical anomalies. One was the prime age labor force actually declined by 1.1 million workers. So these are folks between the ages of 25 and 54, and over 1.1 million of them left the labor force between July 2009 and December 2016. The second anomaly that we observed was, and Madsen's not going to like this because I'm going to use a bit of jargon for a moment, the contribution of capital deepening to productivity growth turned negative for several years of the expansion through 2016. What does that mean? That means that firms' investment in new plant and equipment per worker was insufficient to keep pace with depreciation of existing plant and equipment per worker. So when we were working on the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, there were a couple things we wanted to do. One is to incentivize higher labor force participation by lowering marginal personal income tax rates. But we also recognized that in a world where capital is mobile, where plants and equipment can move across borders, the burden of corporate income taxation is disproportionately borne by labor, which isn't as mobile. And in fact, there's a lot of recent empirical research that finds that well over 50% of the burden of corporate income taxation is borne by workers, and particularly less skilled workers. So one of the signature elements of the 2017 tax law was both a reduction in the statutory corporate income tax rate, but also the introduction of full expensing for new equipment investment. So that lowers the cost of capital, incentivizes domestic capital formation. And so we see in the long run, you get more plant and equipment per worker. That feeds into higher productivity, higher wages, but also in the short run, look, it was a net tax cut, and that both raises aggregate demand in the near term, but also one thing that we find is that more profitable industries tend to pay higher wages. So there's some degree of rent sharing that goes on, and part of the 2017 tax law was a near-term windfall for a few highly profitable firms like Apple, like Google, that had a lot of past earnings parked overseas. That came back, and there's a lot of rent sharing that goes on between, profit sharing that goes on between workers and firms. And when you lower the effective corporate tax rate domestically relative to the rest of the world, that enhances workers' bargaining power. So there's a near-term bargaining channel through which we expected to observe higher wages. So there's both a long-run channel and a short-run channel. And I think that those are the main reasons why we observe such strong wage gains in the aftermath of the 2017 tax law, and particularly at the lower end of the distributions.
Yeah, I think full expensing is one of those kind of golden kind of technical tax changes that does seem to have a huge effect. And we've been pushing that in the UK. And of course, Rishi's super deduction is, as he's calling, is 120% deduction, at least for machinery, though not for buildings, and does very much seem like a step in the right direction. I was kind of wondering your thoughts, though, perhaps on a step in the wrong direction on the G7 agreement to effectively form a tax cartel, and how that could not only potentially push up global tax rates and increase tax on investment that we know corporate tax already is, but also if that's designed badly, it can undermine a lot of that, the full expensing, if we don't actually allow full expensing as part of that, the global minimum tax, if that's not considered by it, you could actually have a lot less flexibility in your tax system, I think is a potential risk there in my mind. I was wondering if you've had a look at that.
Yeah, so I'm very concerned about what's been going on at the OECD, because as you put it, it does amount to the cartelization of international tax competition. And generally speaking, competition between governments tends to be a good thing. And as mobile as capital and income are across international borders, they're even more mobile across intranational borders. And isn't it interesting to observe that in 200 years of tax competition between US states, we have arrived at a state of affairs in which the largest sources of revenue at the subnational level in the United States are taxes on immovable property and consumption taxes, which tend to be more efficient taxes. So I do worry about the cartelization of international tax competition, and I'm sure that there will be creative ways to get around these. I mean, for example, to get around the residual profits tax, which would probably look like, you know, defining a maximum rate of return on tangible assets, and then anything above that rate of return would be classified as excess profits and therefore subject to a global residual tax that would then be allocated on a formulary basis to different tax jurisdictions. You know, you might be able to get around that by, you know, you're a US company like Amazon and you buy an on-the-ground distributor in France to raise your global tangible assets. But the bottom line is it's moving toward less rather than more efficiency.
And the current US President Biden talks a good game on tax havens. I know that a lot of OECD country leaders love talking about tax havens because they see them as their inherent competition. Lots of consumers actually benefit from having that free flow of capital right across the world, and especially in goods and services they don't even realize form part of the products that they buy on their shelves. I was just wondering, do you think that President Biden is going to come to terms with the fact that he's, you know, used to be from a state that was very much tax haven in the United States, and how's he going to deal with the issue at home before he deals with it abroad? And does the U.S. have a right to set the tax rates for the rest of the world? And in that kind of way, isn't the U.S. founded on the very principle of non-intervention, non-taxation without representation?
Well, I certainly can't speak for the administration. What I can say is that whatever is agreed to at the OECD will likely have to be approved by Congress. And there may be bilateral tax treaties that have to be renegotiated as a result of this. And those too would have to be approved by the Senate. And I do have a hard time seeing that happen, at least with the makeup of the current Congress. So I think checks and balances. There's a long road yet to travel before this becomes the law, at least in the United States.
Tyler, jumping back a little bit into some of your kind of academic work, I'm interested to tackle kind of what you were arguing a few years ago and what we've learned since in Legislating Instability, which is kind of a historic look at the Scottish free banking and how, in fact, a lack of government controls with no central bank or currency or lender of last resort was actually a relatively stable system, in fact, more stable than Adam Smith even thought at the time. I was wondering what you think this says about our current struggles to successfully regulate banks.
Right. So in most of my academic work before joining government, I focused on this basic observation that when you look across time and space, the basic contracting structure in banking is pretty constant. What banks do, the sort of basic contracting structure that they use, is pretty constant across time and then across countries. But when you look across time and space, the frequency and severity of banking crises is highly inconstant. And this is something that my colleague, Steve Haber, and his co-author, Charlie Calamiris, have written a lot about. But just as an example, since the early 1800s in the United States, we've had no fewer than 12 major banking crises during the same period. Our neighbor to the north, roughly similar economy, roughly similar geography, similar legal tradition, has had none. Between the establishment of the Bank of England and 1845, the UK had one, two, three, four, five, five or six major banking crises, and then arguably from 1845 to 2008, not one. It depends a little bit on how you classify, how you quantify or classify a banking crisis, but period of considerable stability. And so my research very much focused on examples of good banking and bad banking, where good banking is a banking system that, is relatively crisis insusceptible. In the event of a crisis, it's relatively crisis resilient and attenuates rather than amplifies the transmission of adverse shocks to the real economy, and is engaged primarily in the business of providing relatively short-term working capital to firms and households, leaving riskier investments and longer-term investments to equity markets, both public and private equity markets. And liability, in the event of institutional insolvency, liability is for the most part efficiently allocated. And then bad banking is sort of the reverse of all that. So that was sort of what a lot of my work was focused on before. And in terms of policy relevance, I think there are a couple of things. First, in the context of a major adverse shock like what we experienced in 2020, when for the US at least, we were projected to suffer a GDP decline of 12% during the four quarters of 2020, which would have marked the biggest economic contraction since 1932. And one thing that we were very concerned about was mitigating the risk of financial markets amplifying that shock and transmitting it to the entirety of the U.S. economy. And so there were a number of income replacement measures that we introduced to help mitigate that. The second thing that increasingly concerns me about how we are interacting with the banking system, how we're regulating the banking system, is that regulatory responses to 2008, 2009 increasingly have a sort of one-size-fits-all approach, that we're administering the same stress tests to a whole large set of financial institutions. The metrics for passing those stress tests are the same risk-weighted capital ratios for institutions. And so even if individual banks are becoming safer, less risky as a result of these new macroprudential tools, and in concert with the microprudential tools, if banks are increasingly looking more and more alike, then we are elevating, almost by definition, we are elevating the level of systemic risk in the banking system. And I think that's my biggest concern.
I've seen
that. Look on the pattern of the past 10 years.
I think that's almost certainly true, especially that's kind of what the Basel rules are designed to do, to semi-harmonize banks and their operations across multiple states. And in many ways, sort of normalize the interventionism that governments do on behalf of banks in the event of large-scale macroeconomic crises and financial tightening. On the other hand, harmonizing structures, especially when that are based on a fiat currency system, based on the central banking model, when there is a new up and coming financial system that's almost in sort of in tandem with it in terms of not tied to a fiat currency, sort of the cryptocurrency or stable coin, as some people will call it. Do you reckon that growing up might create very different, very strongly divergent financial systems that actually one operating within states and because of states, and one operating between, and are they going to come into conflict at some point? And how do the corrections work between those two?
So I don't want to cast too broad a brush, because the variety in the stable coin world is so great, and I can think of contracts in which what I'm about to say might not be the case. But by and large, if you are a stable coin, you are issuing a liability that is backed buy some sort of asset. I mean, maybe it's really short. If you're talking about Libra or Diem, they're backed by highly liquid, relatively short-term treasuries or German bunds. I hate to break it to you, but you are a bank. You might be a very safe bank. And you could also be sort of a, if you're backed by gold, then maybe you're a 100% fractional reserve bank that resembles early Goldsmith bankers. But you are a bank. And therefore, I think it does potentially give rise to some of the vulnerabilities of the banking contracting model, which is basically that what banks do is they issue short-term liabilities, relatively short-term, relatively liquid liabilities, in order to fund investment in relatively longer-term, relatively less liquid assets, the value of which can be opaque. And so when there's an adverse macroeconomic shock that occurs, the folks who hold those liabilities know that there's been an adverse macroeconomic shock that's going to impair some tranche of the assets of the issuing bank, but they don't necessarily know the incidence across banks. So in order not to be last in line in a first come first serve system of redemption, there's an incentive to run. So I think that a lot of the, at least in the stablecoin world, a lot of the vulnerabilities of banks exist there as well, which is one reason why monetary authorities, financial regulatory authorities, I suspect will be paying closer attention.
Just stepping out a bit into the kind of your insights about where you think the global economy is going. Are you kind of bullshy and you think things are going to recover relatively quickly? Or are we going to have a quite varied economic recovery across the world? And where do you see kind of recovering faster and slower in the world? Which countries are going to do well and which countries are going to do badly?
So that's a great question. And yes, I mean, as has been the case for most of the past 15, 16 months, so much is driven by the health crisis. And so certainly globally, I expect those countries that are farther ahead on the vaccination front to do better. There are a number of countries, particularly in East Asia and Oceania, that did very, very well pre-vaccine, and now they are very, as folks know, they are very far behind on the vaccination front. Near term, this is particularly true for the US, but near term, I do think that there are some risks from you might call it a fourth wave, because vaccinations are still below thresholds that we would expect for so-called herd immunity in a lot of parts of the country. And I think those there are a lot of vulnerable populations in those parts of the country. So I am concerned about a potential fourth wave. And also there were a lot of emergency measures that were introduced in 2020 that were extended, re-extended. And as some of those emergency measures come to an end, I do worry about households, renters, students facing balloon payments because there's been so much deferral of a lot of these payments. And so rent, student loans, mortgages. And so I think there could be a lot of some pressures as those balloon payments come due.
So do you think that's going to be seen as a cost push inflation, or do you reckon that we're going to end up with some form of sort of money supply issue that's going to mean a real level of inflation? Is Milton Friedman's adage right that inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon still the case? And how do we square that with how people at least see how quantitative easing works or doesn't work in their minds when it comes to feeding through into inflation? How should people see inflation over the next year or so?
So in a previous and now again current life, I was an academic, and now I'm an academic economic historian. And so I think reflecting on both recent and less recent history is perhaps instructive here. So first, I think it's important not to be driving by looking in the rearview mirror. What do I mean by that? I mean by that, in the aftermath of 2008, 2009, we had extraordinary unconventional monetary policy, but a lot of that was offset by the fact that, for example, the Federal Reserve was immediately mopping that up by paying interest on excess reserves. So we saw bank reserves held at the monetary authority just explode. And also after 2009, the contribution of government spending to real GDP growth in the United States actually turned negative. This was in the context of sequestration. So monetary policy wasn't quite as expansionary as I think on the face of it we thought. And secondly, fiscal policy was not turbocharged in the aftermath of 2009, or more in the aftermath of 2010.
Is it though now? Is Biden's administration and the stimulus package, is that fiscally much more hot than it was in 2008 during the Obama years?
Yes. So first of all, I think that there is a fundamental tension at play here, because on the one hand, monetary authorities are saying we've adopted a new regime of average inflation targeting, and there are perfect merits for adopting that new regime. At the same time, fiscal policy makers are saying this administration is the second coming of LBJ, but set your inflation expectations on the basis of the past 10 years, on the basis of the old fiscal and monetary policy regime. So I think there's a fundamental tension there. And casting our minds back to the experience of the 1960s, I think is quite instructive, because actually on the eve of the pandemic, so end of 2019, I gave a talk to the Bureau of Labor Statistics in which I was arguing that even though the unemployment rate in the United States had been below 4% for something like 18 months, I didn't expect inflationary pressure to be coming down the pike, because in contrast to the 1960s, when labor force participation among prime age males was like 98%, and while females were starting to enter the labor force, that was a longer run, slower process. But in 2019, we saw 3/4 of the flows into employment being people coming in from out of the labor force. So there was a lot of remaining labor market slack. Second key difference was the composition of fiscal policy. So in the 1960s, we saw the Great Society program, big increases in aggregate demand, particularly in certain sectors. Those were bumping up against short run, inelastic aggregate supply curves. So in sectors like healthcare in the 1960s, we were seeing several years of double digit inflation. In contrast, the fiscal policy expansion in 2018, 2019 was much more supply side driven because of the contours of the 2017 tax law. And then finally, I think the other difference that I observed at the end of 2019 was I felt monetary policy had learned so much from the experience of the 1960s, when there had been such hubris back in the 1960s that, look, we have hit upon a very stable relationship between inflation and unemployment. We can exploit that in the short run. And yes, there's some inflation there, but that's transitory. Yes, there's some inflation there, but that's a one-off. And so really, inflation expectations became unhinged, unanchored in the latter half of the 1960s, before the supply shocks of the 1970s. So I think that is definitely a worry of mine, is that, you know, we're saying we're in a big bold new world here on the fiscal and monetary policy front, but, you know, keep your inflation expectations according to the previous regime.
So yeah. Tom, kind of mentioned what you said to some of our economist friends who are big advocates of nominal GDP, who say that we've been under targeted nominal GDP for a long time. That's held back employment, it's held back economic growth, and therefore a little bit of inflation right now isn't necessarily the worst outcome. And then I suppose to them, what indicators are you watching that we can point to which will prove your concerns about inflation right and their not worries about inflation wrong? Is there something coming up? Is there something on your mind? What will be the indicator that will say we have inflation now, we should be worried, get to all stations and start raising interest rates?
So the key indicator, the key variable that I'll be looking at is the price of shelter. It's the single biggest component of US measures of inflation. It's a huge component of people's consumption baskets. Rent and imputed rent. So for imputed rent for owner occupiers is going to be the key thing that I'm going to be keeping an eye on.
What are you seeing there so far?
We haven't seen that so far.
Inflation in timber and all these kind of intermediate goods, but it hasn't fed through. I was reading an article in The Hill that kind of discussed how wage rises, at least so far, are illusionary because we've had inflation. And I suppose that you can see that another indicator that we have high levels of inflation, or we've just got kind of stable wages and we don't have wage growth. Is that just another concerning indicator, but a slightly different one?
Right. So, and it's difficult at this stage in a recovery to measure real wages because there are compositional effects. But with the data we have, it does seem to be the case that real wages have been declining. And if we look at things like, for the US, the employer cost index, which addresses some of those compositional issues, at least for the first 3 months of the year, it was the case that the price level increases were outstripping average wage increases or average compensation increases. I should say, my base case is not that we have a repeat of the 1960s and 1970s. A lot of this stuff does seem to be temporary. I think the monetary policymakers learned so much in the aftermath in the 1960s and 1970s. As you suggested, we undershot inflation by so much in the 10 years or so since the 2008-2009 crisis that it would take some time running above target to just offset that. Now, whether or not expectations remain anchored, after 6 months, 12 months, 24 months of inflation running at 3% or more, is an open question and a pretty tricky experiment. But I think my first biggest concern would be that we avoid substantially higher inflation because after a period of letting things run very, very hot, monetary authorities aggressively course correct and
interest rates go up. Isn't though that going to cause other problems? I mean, I particularly think now how indebted governments are. That's a huge increase in the cost of servicing debt, the ability to provide public services. That's increases in people's mortgage repayments and credit card repayments. Is that going to kind of stymite any recovery in the next 5 to 10 years? So I should also add that if anyone has any questions, do please put it in the Q&A.
Right. So at the end of the day, interest rates, nominal interest rates, are a function of basically four things. So-called R star, which is the risk-free global interest rate, real interest rate, a real term premium, inflation expectations, and an inflation premium. So even if nothing has happened to R star, even if nothing's happened to the real risk premium, even if nothing has happened to expected inflation, there's perhaps now an increase in the inflation risk premium that wasn't there in previous years. And so that does imply higher interest rates. And I think the risk is, does a capital structure and portfolio that were capital structure and portfolio that were constructed under the old regime make the same sense under a regime of a higher inflation premium? And it could be the capital reallocations that happen in that new regime could be pretty disruptive.
I've got really just one more before we move on to the Q&A. Please do send them in if you've got the questions. I've got a few coming in. Q&A, I've got a few in my WhatsApp. In terms of, you mentioned of shelter as being your primary figure that you're going to be looking at. It was really interesting because last week I had a discussion on radio with a left-wing commentator who said, we're talking about wealth accumulation during the pandemic and how about whether it was earned or unearned and I was talking about how, the guys who invented Pfizer's vaccine becoming billionaires is not something to be worried about. But he was really talking, and we were talking cross purposes, because he was talking about wealth accumulation of people who own homes and the value of people having, you know, an extra garden or having an extra bedroom or an extra garden, a bit of space. That means that lots and lots of people who were incumbent asset owners on homes were a lot richer. Now, the people who rent out those properties in the Bay Area haven't done very well, but people who have owned homes on the periphery have. I think you've lost...
Oh, we seem to be losing Matt with classic Zoom technological troubles. Yeah, I don't know if you wanted to kind of go from there in terms of what Matt...
Well, I only heard bits and pieces, so in terms of the price pressures coming from the housing market, for non-incumbents in housing markets, that is likely to be a source of upward pressure on average consumption baskets, because, I mean, as I said, that rent is the biggest component of most people's consumption baskets, at least for non-incumbents, also imputed rent's probably going to go up. And rents, that is a shoe that hasn't yet dropped, because rents plummeted, including where, as I mentioned, where I now live, rents plummeted in 2020, and I suspect landlords will be keen to start getting rents back up to the sorts of levels that prevailed on the eve of the shock.
Let's move on to some questions. We've got one from Eamon Butler. If I've got quite a few questions from Eamon Butler, but I think I'm going to choose one that's a bit more historically focused. You've written about the economics of the 19th century famine in Ireland. Are the economic parallels with the pandemic today?
So I think one of the key things I learned in studying the part of the famine was the importance of access to credit in facilitating adjustments to this adverse environmental shock along non-environmental margins. So the sorts of non-demographic adjustments that we observed over the longer period in Ireland, changes in land use, accumulation of short-run buffer livestock assets, those sorts of adjustments took place sooner and to a greater extent in areas where poor farmers had access to small loan credit, so that a binding credit constraint was at least partially relaxed. I would be cautious to draw too many parallels between subsistence 1840s Ireland and the present context. But I will say that I think it was important to make sure, in the context of an adverse shock of historic proportions, to ensure that both small firms and households retained access to sufficient liquidity to get through that shock. And for small firms, I think in particular, we look at there were a whole host of credit facilities that were unveiled by the rolled out by the Fed, some facilities that were capitalized by the Department of the Treasury, and then of course the Paycheck Protection Program, which offered forgivable loans for small medium sized enterprises provided they used those loans to maintain payroll and use them for certain other fixed costs.
Yeah, I mean, I think government's probably broadly responded quite well in terms of keeping the economy on life support for the period of the pandemic, just to keep economic connections rather than letting everything fall apart and letting the structure fall apart. I think it's quite a unique kind of economic freezing that we did that's really incomparable to anything else ever before, because previous recessions have not been effectively man-made. We decided to make this recession through government mandate for arguably good public health reasons, and then we had to pause everything else. I'm interested in this question from anonymous attendee. What was the most challenging slash interesting aspect of your job as CEA chair, and how did you find your interactions with Trump on economic policy, if any?
So I'll answer the second question first. I think had President Trump been a Democratic president, he would have been hailed for assembling a team of rivals, because if we just look at the economic space, the economic team consisted of Secretary Mnuchin, Director Kudlow, Chairman Hassid, and then subsequently when I was elevated to chairman. And then you had Bob Lighthizer, the United States Trade Representative. You had Peter Navarro. You had Secretary Ross. So it was quite a mix.
What were the factions here for those who aren't familiar with all those different names? What were the kind of
right? So you have on the one hand Secretary Mnuchin and Director Kudlow, who were very much coming from a free trade tradition and advocated very strongly on that behalf.
Where you put yourself with them, or are you a separate faction aside?
I would describe myself as a free trader, but one who recognizes that when it comes to an economy like that of China, at the end of the day, China is a $14 trillion non-market economy. And when you are a $14 trillion non-market economy, you are not a price taker, you are a price maker. And one thing that we know about non-market economies is that they do not allocate resources, factors of production efficiently. So whatever the global allocation of capital and labor would have been over the 20 years since the People's Republic of China was granted permanent normal trade relations, we can be pretty confident that that global allocation of capital and labor would have been more efficient in the counterfactual state of the world than in the real state of the world.
Surely you could be a little bit disappointed by, let's say, tariffs as a response to that. I mean, surely that makes Americans poorer, even if China's behaving badly. And there's probably strong evidence that it undermines a lot of the good work that you were doing on the regulatory side or you're doing on the tax side.
So I think one thing that was not possible in 2018 that is increasingly possible looking forward is greater coordination with other major advanced economies to address the China challenge. Because other capitals just weren't quite there in 2018, 2019. And at the end of the day, all politics are local. But just to put some magnitudes on this, an independent commission estimated that annually the economic cost to the US economy of unfair trade practices and intellectual property practices by the People's Republic of China were imposing damages of about $300 billion annually. So right now the real discount rate is about 3%. So if you think about that $300 billion as a perpetual reverse annuity, the present discount of value of that is $10 trillion. In 2018, we had some experts from the OECD visit to talk about trends in trade and counterfeit and pirated goods, which in 2016 amounted to just over half a trillion dollars globally. And of course, the People's Republic of China was number one. We asked them who's number two, and they said there is no number two. I mean, number two is a rounding error. And you know, as I said, when you have a non-market economy of that size, it affects the global allocation of factors of production. So one thing that we observed in the run-up to 2008 is that there were enormous export earnings piling up in China. Ordinarily, that would result in a real exchange rate appreciation. The People's Bank of China prevented that by maintaining capital control. So this was the global savings glut that former chairman Bernanke's talked about. This was the conundrum that former chairman Greenspan talked about, that there was a scarcity of safe assets because there were all these export earnings in China looking to be parked in dollars, looking to be parked in safe assets. So they're plowing them into treasuries. That drove down yields on safe assets. So how did Wall Street respond? By creating artificial synthetic safe assets. So I think there are a lot of second and third order effects of a non-market economy of that size integrated.
So, I mean, that's sort of my mind doesn't justify, you know, taxes on your consumers to solve that problem. What do you think is justifiable? I mean, I understand you could maybe argue the Trump tariffs are necessary to bring attention to something, but in my mind, I think they're going to inevitably make American consumers poorer. They're going to make it more expensive to produce goods, obviously, because a lot of American producers depend on inputs from Chinese factories, whatever else it may be. I suppose, is what you're looking for, or proposing then, a kind of broader decoupling from China or Chinese economy altogether? Should the West completely disconnect any economic connections from China? Is that realistic, or is that something, the only way to solve effectively what you're talking about, which is their level of distortion in the global economy?
Well, I think what is imperative is continued enhancement of collaboration and coordination between advanced economies to pressure China to adhere to global norms. And in the absence of a willingness to do so, to impose substantial costs. But it is a concern that I, at the end of the day, I don't know that China can fundamentally reform, because at the end of the day, state-owned enterprises inhere in that model. State subsidization of key industries inheres in that model. So I think it's a very tricky nut to crack.
I'll stop pushing on that one. My colleague Daniel Pryor is asking if there's anything that you're pushing hard for in economic reform that should be done. Is there any kind of big missed opportunity that you see, or something that, you know, if you had another 4 years, you might have been able to do?
So there are a lot of provisions in the 2017 tax law that, in order to stay within the budget resolution of $1.5 trillion over 10 years, were legislated to sunset. So those include the full expensing of new equipment investment. I think that should be made permanent and ideally expanded to other asset categories. A lot of the changes on the individual side, almost all of the changes on the individual side, are also legislated to start to sunset after 2025. I think that there are a number of provisions there that were very good for labor force participation and very good for efficiency. One of the basic premises of good tax policy is you want to lower marginal rates and broaden the base. So one thing that we did in the 2017 tax law was we lowered marginal rates and we closed some deductions that had previously been used most intensively by those at the very highest end of the income distribution. So I point in particular to the mortgage interest deduction and the state and local tax deduction. So you can deduct from your federal tax liability as taxes paid at the state and local levels. Those two deductions skewed enormously to the very, very high end of the income distribution. They actually, particularly in supply in inelastic housing markets, they're fully reflected in housing prices. So the effect of those deductions is basically to price to give the top 1% of tax filers a big net tax cut, and to price non-incumbents in housing markets out of the housing ladder.
It is totally mind-boggling from a tax principles perspective to be able to deduct your mortgage from your tax bill. It just doesn't really make any sense as something. It's not an expense to do it with your business. It's just going to inflate inevitably. We have a question from Duncan Simpson. I think it speaks to some of the challenges we're facing. The Conservative Party has shamelessly jested any pretense of being supporters of fiscal prudence and genuine tax reform. What lessons could potentially be applied in the UK from the successes of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Acts to help sway the argument over here, as you move out of the pandemic? And even just extending that, perhaps even some of the learnings from regulation and red tape reduction as well from the Trump administration.
Right. So I spoke earlier about, you know, relatively cheap lunches. So certainly regulatory changes that facilitate the movement of people to where productivity growth is relatively high is certainly one. We actually, at the Council of Economic Advisors, studied a whole host of deregulatory changes made by the Trump administration. They included things like allowing consumers to opt out of data sharing, giving consumers greater flexibility to opt out of data sharing with internet service providers, and that opt out rather than a default, you pay with cash, actually lowered prices. We also looked at the effects of expediting the process of approval for new generic drug entries by the Food and Drug Administration. That bent the curve on cost inflation for a whole host of medical pharmaceutical products. these sorts of deregulatory actions, people think about deregulation as being all environmental, but actually a lot of regulation is in areas like consumer basics, groceries, utilities are a big one, healthcare. And these sorts of consumer basics tend to constitute a bigger share of disposable personal income for households at the lower end of the income distribution. Mm-hmm. So making these sorts of regulatory changes can be good both for efficiency and for raising take-home pay at the lower end of the distributions.
Yeah, I think COVID, if anything, showed the danger of excessive regulation to public health, particularly when it came to COVID testing and the CDC and FDA initial hesitancy to allow broader testing in the community. We had the same experience in the UK where red tape of regulation is just absolutely holding us back. It's kind of excessively safety and overly controlled. Just back to Duncan's original question, though, is there anything we can learn in terms of advocating for tax reform in the UK that we can take out of the recent US experience? What worked? Now, Duncan's obviously from the Taxpayers Alliance and is very interested in the kind of advocacy element of it.
Right. So I think one of the key aspects of getting corporate tax reform over the finish line in the United States was to move away from focusing on, oh, this is going to raise long-run GDP by 3%. This is going to increase the capital stock by 9%. And to focus more on how does this affect workers? And so we studied a whole host of recent empirical studies that showed that, you know, this is not the world of 1960s Al Harberger, who found that back then capital was relatively less mobile, so capital bore more of the economic incidence of corporate taxation. We found that no, today the burden of corporate income taxation is disproportionately borne by workers and disproportionately borne by workers at the lower end of the income distribution. And so we actually took estimates from all those papers and gave a range of estimates for what corporate tax reform would imply for wages. I think that was really key. And I think just giving some context to how not all tax cuts are equal. So one of the things the total cost of the corporate tax provisions in the 2017 tax law was about $330 billion over 10 years out of $1.5 trillion. The bill also included a doubling of the child tax credit and substantial increase of eligibility for the child tax credit. Now, there are lots of normative reasons to do, and some positive reasons to do, engage in an expansion of the child tax credit. But one thing is sure, that is not going to be, maybe there's a long-run fertility channel through which that's operating, but that's not going to be doing a lot for potential output growth.
An ASI paper calculated that abolishing the factory tax, which is kind of providing full expensing, could boost UK GDP by over £2,000 per worker, which feels like a quite big kind of bump in productivity. And I think you're right. It's about making that case about the impact on individuals and just how our living standards really in the UK have been pretty stagnant for the last decade. And this tax change can really have a big impact on that. Just a final question about what scares you the most about Biden's economic policies. What should we be shuddering at? Is it this inflation that could have a real global impact as a result of this huge amount of stimulus spending? Or is there something else? Is it all the re-regulations and the new red tape that he's bringing in?
That's an excellent question. I do certainly worry about replicating what was the slowest labor market recovery of the post-war period by rushing to re-regulate, rushing to either allow tax reform to expire or imposing new taxes on US workers and US firms. And then, yes, the risk that in the context of all the repeated transitory shocks to inflation that we've observed in recent months and will likely observe for a few more months, to then layer on top of that a $1.9 trillion American relief plan, a lot of which was not COVID related, and then a $1 trillion bipartisan infrastructure plan, and then a $4 to $6 trillion budget reconciliation bill combining elements of the American Families Plan and the American Jobs Plan. That is a lot of near-term increase in aggregate demand without doing much on the supply side. And that does risk unanchoring inflation expectations, certainly.
Well, I think we've now hit 7 p.m. here in London and 11 a.m. over on in the Pacific. I just want to thank you so much for taking the time to come and speak to us this evening. It has been a real huge honor to get your insight and your background and your thoughts on a whole wide array of topics. And I think we're all very excited about the next stages in your career and the kind of research and the kind of influence you're going to be able to have from the academic side of the world. And we're very much humbled to have you consider both a friend of the ASI as well as our latest senior fellow. I know you have an extraordinary amount of opportunities now that you've left the White House, and we're really honored that we're part of your next stage and look forward to working with you on a whole bunch of different projects in future and keeping you in touch. And I think the other good news is apparently it looks like the football's coming home, although it's probably something that not too many people on this call have really focused in on. But we do thank everyone for taking the time to speak to us. And I'm sorry, Matt Kilcoyne, and his internet dropped out earlier. He didn't leave it in a strike of offense or anything. It was very much a technical problem. So thank you very much, Tyler.
Thank you so much. And I've had a long history with that at Smith Institute, so it's good to continue and continue that relationship. And yeah, very much looking forward to working with the whole team moving forward.
Well, thank you very much. Have a good day.
Too.